Welcome to the third hour of User Interface Strategies 92. Our guest the third hour is Brad Myers, who's a research scientist at Carnegie Mellon University. He's long been a leader in creating the new world of user interface development environments. His topic for today is extending direct manipulation, the demonstrational interfaces, and user interface development environments. Brad?
Thank you, Ben. Before I start, I just want to make two small announcements. First of all, on the notes that I'll be using, the ones in the proceedings you have are a subset of the ones I'm going to be using. I was practicing my talk and it came out too short, very unusual, so I added some new material. And secondly, there always has to be some kind of technical snafu in a printing job this large. And sure enough, they left out all the even pages of one of my papers, the one on page 153, and those will be sent to the organizers of each site sometime soon. Okay, so now to the interesting material, demonstrational interfaces and user interface development environments. And of course, I have to tell you what these are because at least some of these terms are probably not very familiar since one of them I made up. And I want to try and tell you what these kinds of systems are, what they're used for. Then I'm going to switch a little bit and talk about user interface development environments, and then try and combine these two topics and tell you why demonstrational interfaces can be used to extend user interface development environments. So what is a demonstrational interface? Well, my definition is that it's when the user demonstrates, when he operates by direct manipulation on a concrete object, and that's the standard definition of direct manipulation, but that object, in addition to representing itself, also represents a class of objects. So therefore, it's an example of an instance of that class. And then to generalize from that example to the whole class, that can either be done by the user explicitly or automatically by the system. And I'm calling it demonstrational interfaces because you're demonstrating the desired result on a particular example. Many of you might be familiar with the Emacs text editor, and so an instance of this demonstrational kind of interface is the way you can make macros in Emacs. You give editor commands in the normal way. The system can be put into a mode where it's going to remember those commands, but they're going to operate while you're executing, while it's being remembered. You stop remembering, and then you can execute that macro again in another location. Now, I'm calling this a demonstrational interfaces because while you're making this program, this macro, it's executing those commands on the text. And so you're seeing it operate. Now, the term demonstrational interfaces has often been equated with the term programming by example, but I want to emphasize that they're different. First of all, programming by example has typically been an area of artificial intelligence research, but demonstrational interfaces do not necessarily have to incorporate intelligence. They don't have to be AI kinds of systems. And secondly, some of the demonstrational systems I'll be showing you, you'd be hard-pressed to really call them programming systems. They're just a little simpler than that. And so the point is that demonstrational systems are more general, more broad than programming by example. And furthermore, because they don't necessarily require advanced intelligence or advanced features, you can use them today, that this kind of technology is available. Many demonstrational systems use heuristics, which sometimes are called guesses. The system has in it rules based on some ideas of what people might do in general, but they won't necessarily be right in every case, okay? And so there's an issue about whether it's okay to use heuristics in a user interface. And of course, my answer to that is yes, it's a good idea in many cases to use heuristics. Now, the problem with heuristics is that the user, because the system might do something or it might not, the user does not necessarily know what the system is going to do. And therefore, it's very important to have appropriate feedback in order to make the system understandable and so the users think they're in control. Well, what is the motivation for demonstrational systems? Well, first of all, they are direct manipulation systems, and so they do have those advantages, all the ones that Ben has been promoting for years. But they have additional nice features. People are better at dealing with particular examples and concrete examples rather than dealing with abstractions. And this is one of the big motivations for direct manipulation in general. Teaching is done by examples. So if you want to try and express an abstraction to the computer, the easiest way is to allow you to do it concretely. But the problem is direct manipulation, which requires concrete objects to point to and think and to refer to, there's nothing necessarily to make concrete, to make visible for a lot of things that are more naturally abstract. There's nothing to make visible. For example, how would you express all objects of type Y? Okay, that's a hard thing to express concretely. How do you express do command Z if the disk is almost full? These are just some examples of the kinds of things you might be able to express very easily in a command-based user interface, but they're very difficult to do in a direct manipulation interface. Here's an example of that problem. Imagine you were trying to build a direct manipulation editor that would let you create new kinds of menus. You wanted to have the ability for the user to design a new kind of menu. Maybe you want it to look like this, very fancy, all these kinds of pretty boxes around it. And you'll notice that the rectangles here adjust their size based on the size of the strings. Now, this is the kind of code that you'd have to write, and naturally you're not going to be able to read it, but you can imagine what it's like. It's full of constants, like the size of the boxes, the offsets, and constants like the particular colors. You don't want to have to write this code in order to try and investigate these kinds of designs. What you want to do is to be able to draw these pictures, okay? But how are you going to draw the pictures if you don't have any strings? You need to be able to draw the strings, edit, file, and window, in order to be able to have something for the rectangles to go around. You just cannot do this task without having example strings. But you want your menu to work for any set of strings. You don't want it just to be for these three strings, obviously. So clearly, the example strings you use are just representative. They're just placeholders. And you need the system to work. You need it to be able to generalize from those strings to an arbitrary set. Another thing that we've noticed is that programming is a very useful thing for people to be able to do. And it's also useful for non-programmers, for the general populace. But the problem is that users really don't want to learn how to learn a programming language. They don't want to have to learn a new way of expressing things. But they really have a task in mind, and often those tasks are custom to each particular person, and they need a way of expressing it. And the clearest example of this is spreadsheets. One of the important reasons that spreadsheets are so powerful a tool is that people can customize them to their own particular needs, their own particular application, and the way they do this is by writing programs. Writing formulas and macros that you do in spreadsheets is a way of programming. Another example that some programmers are more familiar with is the Unix shell language, where you can you write little scripts and express the kinds of activities you do a lot as a macro. And there are starting to be some of these kinds of tools in the Macintosh. But the problem is for graphical applications like CAD/CAM and many of these drawing programs, there is no graphical expression for the kinds of programs you want to write. And another problem is that people tend to have trouble with the concepts of programming. How do I express the kinds of activities that I want to do? Now, the nice thing about demonstrational interfaces is that they let you express your desires right in the interface. You just do what you do normally, and programs can be created in that way. There's all sorts of techniques that we've developed to make that easier. Now, the next part What I want to try and show you is that this is not necessarily a radical idea, that in fact there are demonstrational systems that are in use every day. The first one I'm going to show you is MacDraw, and I have a little video of that. This is a common Macintosh program, and what happens is that there's a duplicate command, and when you give the duplicate command, the new item comes out in a particular offset from the original. Okay, and that offset is a built-in constant. However, if you move the second copy and then give the duplicate command again, the next one will come out at the same offset as where you moved it. Okay, and so what it's doing is it's using that offset that you gave it as an example of the kind of positioning you probably want. And you can see on my slide it's the same idea. Now this is a heuristic. It might not be where you wanted this item to go. You might have wanted it somewhere else. And in fact, if this one is a far away from this one might be totally off the screen. And so this heuristic can be wrong. Okay, there are other examples, lots of other examples. We already talked about Emacs, how you can record commands. There's another text formatter called Scribe, which is very much like TROF or script or tech or other kinds of text formatters you might be familiar with. In Scribe in particular, if you want to have a date in your document, you want to say the today's date on the headers or whatever, you just use this command right here, @ValueDate, and that puts out the current date. But how do you define the style that that date comes in? In Scribe, all you have to do is give an example of the kind of date that you want to see. And by you looking at this example, the system figures out how to display it. In something like Microsoft Word, there's a whole list of different ways of expressing the date, and there's a dialog box that comes up, and you have to pick which kind of formatting you want. This that you have in Scribe is a lot more flexible, and it's a lot easier to use. Here's another example from Microsoft Word, and it's the renumber command. Okay, and I'll show that on the video. Okay, in Microsoft Word has a command that will automatically renumber sections. Okay, and you'll notice here that the numbering is wrong. And what I'm going to do is select it and give the renumber command. Renumber has an option where it'll renumber by example. And what that means is that it looks at the text, tries to figure out from the text how it's numbered, and uses that as the specification for the new numbering. And you'll see that it has renumbered it correctly. Okay, now there's an interesting issue there. If you look here, this is the before picture. Okay, if we can zoom in right here on this part, you'll see that there are parentheses here at this fourth level. And then in the final result, the parentheses have been changed to periods. Now it did do the renumbering correct, but it has changed the punctuation. And there's a heuristic, obviously, built into Microsoft Word. And I didn't notice this the first few times I was using it. But there's a heuristic built in that says that all the punctuation after the numbering should be the same. Is that correct? Well, it might be, it might not be. But there, you know, this is the heuristic they happen to build into their system. And so the point is that that this is doing a very useful job, but whether the heuristic is doing the right thing or not all the time doesn't necessarily mean that it's not useful. Okay, here's another example. This is a research system that I'm working on right now. Imagine you have a complicated style like this, and you want all your chapters to look this way with the chapter, the word chapter up here, and then a number here, the same number over here, and the title with a line that's the same width. Okay, in my system, you can select that, say define style, then go to a new piece of text, apply that style to it, and it comes up with something that looks like this. So what has it done here? It's had to notice in this style the various roles that the pieces of text are playing. This word chapter is a constant, and it's had to put that in. It's determined that these two are numbers and how they're formatted. It's determined that this line is the same length as the text. And it's using heuristics again to try and figure this out. And as a result, it's able to give you a very powerful style mechanism by using these heuristics. And of course, because they're heuristics, it might sometimes guess wrong. Another example is very much like Emacs. There are some systems for direct manipulation interfaces that do record commands. One of them is MacroMaker from Apple, and there's lots of others. And the idea is it just records the positions of the mouse clicks and the text items you type, and then it'll replay them later. The problem is that if the icons and the text objects that you refer to in your macro move, if the icons are in different places later, or if you've changed the names of things, then often these macros will just do the wrong thing because they have remembered the low-level positions instead of the high-level semantics of what the actions might have meant. And so we're working on new techniques for trying to remember these high-level concepts rather than the very low-level things that can get to be wrong. Okay, so now I'm going to switch a little bit and talk about user interface tools and how demonstrational ideas can be used in them. And the reason is because it's the area of creating these user interface tools has proven to be a very fertile area for applying the demonstrational techniques to. Okay, so what is a user interface tool? And I'm using the term user interface tool to refer to any kind of software that helps a person create the software for the user interface. This includes toolkits, and it also includes high-level tools like UIMSs, interface builders, and other kinds of things. So I'm using the word user interface tool in a very general sense, and not just toolkits. Now, it turns out that user interface software is extremely difficult to build, and that it takes up a large amount of the programming task. What we've shown in study after study, and this slide down here shows you some new results from a new study that I'm working on, that 50% of the design time, 50% of the implementation time, the maintenance time, and of the code itself is devoted to the user interface portion. So clearly we're spending a lot of time working on the user interface, we need tools to help make that percent of the time be more effective. Furthermore, the user interface portion is getting to be more important. There's an increasing demand for graphical user interfaces, for better user interfaces, and for people to are no longer willing to accept products that have bad user interfaces. At least that's what we hope. And the good news, on the other hand, is that there are lots of tools available today that will help you with these kinds of tasks. Here's a picture of the kind of structure of these tools. At the bottom, we have hardware. Then we have some kind of operating system. Then there's a windowing system on top of it, something like X or Microsoft Windows or the Macintosh Window Manager. Then on top of that, there's some kind of toolkit, which is a set of procedural interfaces. And then there might be some higher level tools like interface builders and UIMSs. And I'm including both of these categories in the term user interface tools. And then up here at the top, of course, are your application programs. That's what you really want. That's what you're trying to build. So what's a toolkit? A toolkit is a library of widgets that can be called by applications, and a widget is something like a menu or a button or a scroll bar, all the kinds of objects that you want to use in your user interface. And of course, the advantage of using a toolkit is that if you need a menu in your user interface, it's silly to reprogram it because you can just use the one out of the library. And furthermore, by using the standard one, you get consistency because all of your code will work like everybody else's code, and that people will know how to use your menus and that kind of thing, and it'll look the same. Now, toolkits are only used by programmers because they have only a procedural interface. It's a code, it's a body of code that you can call, and toolkits do not include the higher level graphical tools that I'll be talking about later. There are lots of examples of toolkits. The Macintosh Toolbox is one of the most famous. Presentation Manager and Windows for the Mac, for the PC both have toolkits. If you're working on X, then there's Motif and OpenLook, which are XDK toolkits. There's also one for C++ or Next called Interviews. If you're on the Next computer, you're using NextStep. And then I have one that I'm working on called Garnet, which is for Lisp and X. Since toolkits are hard to use, Well, you need higher level tools. What you discover if you're going to build a modern graphical interface is that you have to buy and learn 6 books of information. And this is constant across all sorts of different toolkits. The Macintosh toolbox manuals are 6 books. The X toolkit manual is only 2 books, but they're twice as, 3 times thicker. And the amount of information you have to learn to be an expert at programming at toolboxes are enormous. And there's no evidence that that's getting any better. So what we need are these high-level tools that will hide most of this complexity for us and handle most of these aspects of the problem. And I've identified 3 classes of higher-level tools: prototyping tools, interface builders, and user interface management systems. Prototyping tools allow you to quickly see what the user interface will look like and how it'll act. Interface builders are specifically for laying out widgets, and then user interface management systems are for comprehensive support of the software process. Now, this list here, which is in your book on approximately page 183, and obviously you can't see it on the TV screen, is a listing of just some of the higher level tools that I've found in looking through advertisements and calling around. And the point of this is to give you a sense that there are a lot of tools out there that you can choose from. There are 2 lists here. Both of them have the same tools on them, and they're just sort of different. The first list is sorted by the name of the tool, here, and the second list is sorted by the tool type. And these are the same types that I've been talking to you about: prototypers, interface builders, and that kind of thing. And you can look through this list, and chances are you can find a tool that will help with the kind of application you want to build. Okay, so let's look at what these tools are by my definition. The first set of tools I'm calling prototyping tools. And the idea here is to quickly get an idea of what kind of interface you want to build and to allow you to get a feel for how it's going to look and do some amount of behavior. And by behavior, I mean the response of the system to users' actions, the response to application data changing, the way the graphics change. Now, I want to differentiate these prototyping tools from the general term rapid prototyping. Rapid prototyping has gotten to be a advertising term. Pretty much any of those tools on this list or any software that you buy is going to claim to support rapid prototyping because that's been advertised as a good thing. And what they're trying to mean by that is that you can create your user interface software more quickly. But I'm trying to get a more specific notion here by specifically tools that create these these mock-ups of the interface. And most of the prototyping tools do work by direct manipulation, and they allow you to quickly draw pictures of what you want the interface to look like. And the way they make this easy is by not using the real widgets. They don't necessarily allow you to use the real menus and scroll bars and buttons in your interface, but rather you're just drawing pictures, mock-ups of what you want to see. And because they're not using real widgets, they usually don't allow you to create the real application. Okay, what you're creating is a mock-up, and you then have to throw it away and start over. Now, there's plenty of examples of this kind of system. Probably the most famous is Dan Bricklin's demo program. A lot of people use Macromine Director on the Macintosh, which was built as an animation program. People use it to simulate the kinds of interfaces to see what it would be like to interact with them. And HyperCard on the Macintosh is used both as an application generator and as a prototyping tool for systems that are then later re-implemented in a different way. And I have a little example here of how you might use HyperCard as a prototyping tool. So what I'm doing here is I'm thinking about designing a new kind of button. And what I'm going to do is use the drawing tools just to draw a picture of what I have in mind. And of course, because this is a modern user interface, there's an absolute requirement that it must be a 3D look. And so I drew a drop shadow. And what we're going to do is make the button move down to cover its drop shadow when the end user operates it. And naturally, if I was making this in a real system, I would be a lot more careful. But I just wanted to give you a sense of how fast you can do these kinds of operations with today's prototyping tools. So I've made one view of the button, and I'm going to copy that and then make another view, which is going to be the button after I've pushed it down. And so I'm going to select the top part of it and then move it, which will represent the button in its depressed state after you've pushed it with the mouse. I need that to be opaque so you can't see the shadow through it. Okay, and now I can move it down, and this is what I want it to look like later. And now what I'm going to do is define the properties of this button that lets you move from one of these states to the other. And there's a simple dialog box in which I can do that. I type in the name of the button, and then I can say I want to go to the previous picture when I press on it. Okay, so that was really all you had to do to make this button work. And now I can just go into run mode and then try it out. And I see, sure enough, it does press down. And maybe that's the look I'm trying for. And if not, it's just as easy to edit it and try out different kinds of looks and fields. Now, obviously, when I'm pressing on that button, nothing much is happening. The application isn't running. It's not going off and doing anything. But it's just a simulation, a mock-up of the front end. And that's what you get with prototyping tools. The next class of high-level tools are interface builders, and these are probably the most popular tools today. There are literally hundreds of tools of this category. Most of them are for Microsoft Windows, but for pretty much for any environment you want, you can find an interface builder. And what is an interface builder? It lets you lay out widgets in the user interface. You have a palette of all the different kinds of menus, all the different kinds of buttons, the scroll bars and the text input fields. You select them in the palette, move them into your graphics window, and just draw a picture of what you want your dialog boxes and menus to look like. It's very easy to create these parts of the user interface, the graphics panes, the dialog boxes and menus you create by direct manipulation. But if you have an application like a CAD CAM application or any kind of graphical program, what you end up doing is drawing this graphics pane, this big blank area, and then you have to program that in the regular way just by going down to the toolkit. And so as a result, the dialog boxes are very easy to do by direct manipulation, and there's absolutely no support for the rest of it. Okay. And another nice thing about interface builders is that the code that's created is the actual code that you can use in your application programs. You write special procedures, you attach them to the widgets, to the menus and buttons, and then the interface builder will write out a file which then you link in with your application, and then at runtime you just use that code. So you don't have to actually go ahead and reprogram it at all. As I was saying, there are lots of examples. On the Macintosh, you have the prototyper. The next interface builder is probably one of the most famous of this class. There are a whole bunch of these for X, for either Motif or OpenLook. UIMX is one example. As I said, there are over 100 for MS Windows, and Blue Sky's Window Makers is just one example. There are lots of these on that list, but of course not all of them. And then I have one called Gilt, and I'm going to show you that now. To give you a sense of how interface builders work. Over here you can see the palette of the widgets that you can choose from. You can select which kind of widget you want in your interface and put them down. This happens to be the motif look and feel. Those are radio buttons, and these square ones are checkboxes where you can select more than one of a set. So I put them down here, and then I can select them and move them around. So I didn't like where that was, so I'll just move it. That's very easy to adjust things like that. You can also go in and edit the text labels of the objects. Most interface builders require you to go off in a dialog box to do this, but in Gilt, we're able to let you type right in there to the window. I didn't really want three here, so I'll just delete that. That says bold and italic, and maybe I'm building a dialog box to control the fonts or something. Okay, I'm going to put down a label, which will eventually be the title of my dialog box, and maybe I want to add a text input field. The text input field has a variable width, so I get to drag that out and show it how wide I want. Okay, now I'm going to set some properties of the radio buttons. It turns out in Motif that a radio button has lots of options. There's over 20 different ways you can display a radio button. You can change the font, you can change what side of the label the little diamonds are on, and there's lots of other properties that you can change. You know, how the columns and rows are laid out, whether it goes row first or column first, all this kind of stuff. Here I am using a dialog box to change the font. Okay, then when I hit OK, then the objects in the real window will change to show the options that I've selected. Okay, and so all this is very immediate, very direct, all the kinds of nice properties you like from direct manipulation interfaces. These are kind of messy, so what I'm going to do is select align, the align command, and this will let me specify how I want them arranged, and I'll choose that it should be in a nice, neat column, but I want them centered with respect to each other, and then it'll just go ahead and do that automatically. And then when I hit OK, it will go ahead and adjust the objects up in the main window, and I'll move them in the center so you can see that. So what we've done is created a dialog box by direct manipulation. Now, the problem is there's lots to user interfaces besides just dialog boxes, at least most user interfaces. The question is, what do you do about the rest of the application, the insides of application windows? And that's what user interface management systems try to help with. They try to support the entire application for CAD and other kinds of graphical situations. Now, some of these are not direct manipulation systems. They use special languages, for example, BNFs or transition diagrams, and they might use object-oriented frameworks, an object-oriented programming paradigm, like MacApp, or some of the other ones just give you a framework for doing object-oriented programming, and I'm classifying these as user interface management systems. Now, other systems do use direct manipulation. They do allow you to draw what the application-specific objects look like, and these are the ones that I'm going to be emphasizing here. And again, there are lots of tools that you can buy. Although many user interface management systems are research systems, there are a number of commercial products, and some of these are on the list that I handed out. Okay, well, now I want to move and talk about demonstrational user interface tools. The problem is that, as we've seen, it's very easy to use direct manipulation for the dialog boxes and for that part of the user interface process. But we want to also use direct manipulation for creating the other parts of the application. And so I've developed a series of tools, user interface tools, that explore this. The first one I'm going to talk about is Peridot, which I developed a number of years ago, which lets you create new kinds of widgets, like new menus, new scroll bars, new kinds of buttons, and you get to specify both the graphics and the behaviors in a direct manipulation fashion, by example, in a sense using demonstrational techniques. Now, heuristics are used in Peridot in three different ways. So it's actually guessing things about the interface. It's guessing the graphical constraints, which is how the graphics depend on the examples. If you remember that menu from before, we had the boxes around the strings, and the boxes change size depending on what the length of the string. So Peridot tries to determine these kinds of relationships automatically. The second way it uses heuristics is by determining iterations, and this allows you to do things like say, this menu should work for any list of strings no matter how long it might be, and all you have to do is do two items and the system will do the rest. And then the third way is by trying to determine how the mouse or the keyboard should affect the user interface and how it should change. So I have a video of that system.
The way you do things that vary in a range in Peridot is by drawing each extreme, graphical extreme, and telling the system to remember it. So this will represent when we can see 100% of the file, and we'll tell it to remember it. Now we'll edit this to be say 2 pixels high, and this will correspond to the case when we can't see any of the file. Peridot will infer a linear interpolation between these two values, and will allow us to vary in a range based on this number. So What we're going to do is select the percent seen active value, and this will be what controls how high the bar is. And now it wants us to type the values for percent seen that correspond to the two sizes, and then it immediately updates after we finish that, immediately updates it to be 57 out of 100 tall. Now we're going to change this value just to make sure it works. Now what we're going to do is separately and independently make the indicator bar go up and down based on what part of the file we're seeing. So we'll tell it to remember this is one extreme, and then we'll edit it with the mouse to be the other extreme, which will be, of course, at the top of the bar. So we'll move it up to the top, and then Peridot infers some constraints of the bar at the top of the thing, and then we're going to select it. As you can see, the selection is shown with this animated border, and tell it to remember this as the other extreme. This time the linear interpolation is going to depend on the active value where in file, so we'll select that. And this is represents the position in the file, so we'll just say that the maximum number of characters in the file is 5,000, and then it'll immediately jump to 2,300 out of 5,000, or about the middle of the bar. Now what we want to do is have this bar move with the mouse. Now we can't use the real mouse to demonstrate how it should work, because that's used for giving Peridot commands. So we use the simulated mouse. We press on the left button of the mouse, and then we can say that this bar is mouse dependent. It wants to know what part of the bar the mouse is attached to, and it guesses that it should be the middle, and that's correct. And it guesses that we want the bar to move up and down in a range, and that, of course, is correct also. Now, after it's finished doing this, we can try this out immediately by using the simulated mouse. We can move it up and down. This is a little clumsy, however, so we can use the real mouse by going into run mode. The cursor changes to show that we're running, and we can't give any Peridot commands because the mouse operates like it will for the end user. There's a special keyboard key which turns run mode off. An important point is that linear interpolations do not depend on the particular graphics. The application is independent of the picture. If we edit the graphics, the bar will stay in the right place and at the right percent of the way up and down, and of course it still works with the mouse.
I want to point out the important difference between this system and the prototyping tools that, like the HyperCard system before, is that this one is actually creating parameterized procedures that you could really connect up with your applications. It's really creating menus that can have an arbitrary number of items in it and things like that. Okay, the next system I want to talk about is the guilt system that you've seen before, and what we've tried to do is add some new features to guilt so that it can do a lot more than just your typical interface builder. And naturally, we're trying to extend it by using demonstrational ideas so that you can do more and still use the standard direct manipulation kind of paradigm. So we have two ways we've extended it. The first one is by using what we call graphical styles. And as you saw, widgets have a lot of parameters and properties that you can set to them. So what you can do is create a particular widget with a particular style and then select that and define a style by example, much the way you can do in text editors like Microsoft Word. But then you can apply these styles to different widgets, and this will be a lot faster and helps achieve consistency. And one thing you'll see in the video that I'm going to show a little later is that the styles also have positional information. So you can have different styles for the center, for a text label in the center, as opposed to a text label in the corner, because probably your text labels at the top are going to be titles, so they should be bigger, as opposed to a label on the side that should be smaller. So when you when it's guessing styles using some heuristics, that will take position into account. The next kind of inferencing, or next kind of demonstrational technique we've added is inferencing of transformations of data and dependencies, so we can try and eliminate some callback procedures. An interesting observation is using modern toolkits and interface builders, you have to create a procedure called the callback procedure attached to most of the widgets in the user interface, and your average application can have 2,000 or 5,000 widgets, which means you have, you know, a lot of callback procedures, and these can be a real maintenance nightmare. So what we've done is try to identify how these callbacks are used and replace them with built-in little filters, and we have demonstrational ways of saying what these filters can do. So let me show you how that works. Okay, what we have here is a set of radio buttons formatted like we saw before, and I'm going to define that as a style, so I'm going to type in the name of the style, and I'm also going to give it a column so that it'll be nice and lined up on that dotted line there on the left. And when I say OK, it'll immediately jump to be exactly on that column, and then the style is defined. Now, notice that the style guessing is turned off, so when I put down a label, a set of labeled radio buttons, they aren't lined up. But now when I turn style guessing on, when I put down some radio buttons over there, it's going to see that there's something like that, and it'll adjust them appropriately. Notice they're all lined up nice and neat because they're all on that heading, on that same column. And as I said before, the labels use different styles depending on where they're placed. Okay, this is showing you the other interesting point about dialog boxes, which is that there are often lots of dependencies in the different parts. You notice that the string at the bottom changes based on which font you've selected, and that this whole sets of widgets turn gray or inactive depending on the selection of other widgets. So this dialog box here, the value control window, lets you control this without writing code. What you do instead is give examples of the desired output values from widgets, and it will try and find if it has one of its built-in procedures that'll do that automatically. And sure enough, in this case, it knows how to do the transformations of the constants in the right way. Now, in the other on the other widget, the radio buttons, it doesn't know how to make these transformations. So what you do instead is type in a value that you want, the constant value you want, for each of the possible values of the widgets. And the way you do that is by operating the widget to get it into each of the states, then you type in the value, and the system just makes a case statement, which in Lisp is called cond, that will make sure that the widget has the value that you want for each of the different selections, different values. Okay, and we're doing lots of more exploration to think of new ways of applying these demonstrational techniques to allow interface builders and other graphical tools to go even further. And the next system I want to talk about is also part of Garnet, and that's called Lapidary. And what it lets you do is draw examples of application-specific graphics. Now, we're not talking about widgets here. We're talking about the contents of the graphical windows. Imagine you have, I don't know, some kind of hierarchy diagram or one of the kinds of things you've seen from the other speakers, and you wanted to program that. In most systems today, you'd have to write code for each of these elements, code for the arrows, and you'd have to write code that would figure out how far they should be apart and all these kinds of features. Instead, in Lapidary, what you can do is you draw an example of each of these components of the interface, and you define constraints to show how it depends on the parameters to it, for example, the strings here. Then you can add behaviors, and then you can save the graphics to a file. And the nice thing is that your application program then does not ever have to have graphics calls in it. All it does is create instances of these graphical objects. Let's see how that works.
I would like to create the data and arrow objects for an arithmetic editor. The data object is created by sweeping out a rounded rectangle and entering a sample number. This number's readability can be significantly improved by enlarging its font, which is done using the text properties window. The text properties window also allows the designer to make the value of a string depend on a constraint, which is useful for relating an indicator on a gauge to a property of an application object. The rounded rectangle should be centered around the number and be just large enough to contain the number. The use of constraints ensures that the rounded rectangle will expand and shrink as the number expands and shrinks. The label and the rounded rectangle are next grouped together in an aggregate, which is named data object. Finally, the prototypical data object is saved to a file so that the arithmetic editor can load it and create instances of it. A prototypical operator object could be created in a similar fashion. Now I will create a second data object so that I can create an arrow and demonstrate the arrow's behavior. When I rotate the arrow in the constraint menu rotates as well. This makes it easy to determine which endpoint of the arrow I am constraining. In this case, the arrow's left endpoint is attached to the right side of an object, and its right endpoint is attached to the left side of an object. These constraints are dynamic constraints, since the arrow will stay attached to the data objects if the data objects are moved. As I've saved the arrow, Lapidary notices that the arrow's constraints reference objects that are not being saved. Lapidary infers that these constraints should be generalized so they can reference any object. And with my permission, it replaces direct references with indirect references. This portion of the arithmetic editor specification is complete. Next, we would use Lapidary to create the other objects and the interactor for entering numbers. Then a programmer writes the application functions for doing arithmetic, and the application is ready for testing. The application uses instances of the prototypes Lapidary just created. Notice that the rounded rectangles expand as numbers are input, and that they stay centered around the numbers as specified in Lapidary. The user can move both operators and data around, and the arrows will stay attached to these objects as dictated by Lapidary.
So I hope you've gotten a feel of the kind of power that these kind of demonstrational systems can provide, how you can extend beyond what you can do today with direct manipulation systems. But I don't want to give you the sense that this is a solved problem. There still are lots of interesting issues to explore with demonstrational systems and a lot of research that needs to be done. And some of them are listed here. The first one is that any of these systems that have heuristics are occasionally going to guess wrong. They're going to come up with the wrong result. And so we need to study when this is acceptable. And this is really an issue for human factor studies and the kinds of user studies that Tom was talking about. We need to know when the power that you get by having the system do these kinds of operations for you is enough that it will overcome the problem that sometimes it's doing the wrong thing. And one way to really help with this problem is with appropriate feedback. How to tell the user what the system is doing, how to show what the system has guessed, and how to allow the user to stay in control, to feel like they know what's going on. Another interesting problem is that when you've created these programs, if you think about the examples we've seen, there hasn't been a static representation of what the programs are. There isn't a listing of the code. How do you know what the system really has guessed? How do you edit things? How do you debug them? Well, you really need some kind of static representation for the programs, and so we have to do some more research in trying to figure out what kinds of static representations will be appropriate, what will be understandable, and do we want to really go back and show the generated code like I did in GILT, as you saw in that middle window? That was the real Lisp code. Is that what we want people to see? Well, maybe in some cases, but probably not in all cases. So we need to have interesting new kinds of representations to allow editing and debugging. And the final issue is that these systems can be very difficult to build. Because this is a new technology, there aren't any toolkits or libraries that are going to help you build a demonstrational interface. And so we're looking now in our research at what kinds of ideas might be generally useful that we could think about providing so that you could move these ideas from a text editor to a graphics editor, et cetera. So in conclusion, I hope you've gotten the message that demonstrational interfaces are beneficial, that they can extend the range of what can be done by direct manipulation, and that there are all sorts of interesting problems that direct manipulation interfaces have that we might be able to solve by using example values at runtime, that the user can operate on these example values and then thereby have a demonstrational system instead. Another message I'm trying to convince you of is that the heuristics in the user interface are not evil, that it's really okay if the system is, in a sense, guessing. It's really okay if the system is using strategies to figure out what the user is probably going to want to do, and then to do that in similar situations. And that the commercial products that I've shown you, Microsoft Word and MacDraw, and some of the other ones, are successfully applying this idea. They're not scaring users off or making users think that they're some kind of really intelligent agent in the system or any of these other things that scare people away from using artificial intelligence. Some of these heuristics are small enough and they can be collapsed enough so that the user just thinks the system is doing what they're telling it to do. But the fundamental issue is feedback and predictability. The users have to know they're in control, they have to know what the system is going to do, and they have to be able to have confidence that the system is doing the right thing. And finally, I believe that the demonstrational ideas are particularly powerful when applied to user interface tools, and that you'll be beginning to see interface builders and similar graphical tools that use these demonstrational ideas in the very near future. Well, Ben asked me to give you a one-sentence summary of my whole talk, and I guess that would be two sentences since I have sort of two parts of the talk. The first one is that if you are building user interface software today and you're not using high-level tools like these, then chances are you're doing a lot more work than you need to do. That if you're building software, there are tools that will help you. And then the second part is I hope don't have to say again, but that you should think about investigating demonstrational ideas when you have a situation where it doesn't seem obvious how to make direct manipulation work, or when you find yourself giving users dozens of dialog boxes in order to specify something. Thank you.
Hour of User Interface Strategies 1992. Our guest this hour is Brenda Laurel, who's worked for Apple and Atari, and is the founder of Telepresence Research. She's well known to many of you as being the editor of the book The Art of Human-Computer Interface Design, and her recent book is called Computers as Theater. She's described in glowing terms in Howard Rheingold's recent book called Virtual Reality, which is covering the topic that she's discussing today of telepresence and virtual reality. Brenda?
Thank you, Ben. The title of my talk is Be There Here, which hopefully you're having a little bit of conceptual difficulty with. I've used the virtual reality phrase on here just to help those of you who've heard about virtual reality to calibrate. But in fact, I guess I want to begin my talk by attacking that particular term. We have difficulty with that term at Telepresence, and many of the people who work in the business have difficulty using it, because it's either an oxymoron, because if it's virtual, it's not reality, or it's grammatically incorrect, because if virtual realities can be realities, then they're certainly plural and not singular. Another reason to avoid virtual reality for us is that there's been so much hype and press attention about virtual reality, and we sort of wanted to avoid the fate of AI, which suffered similar overhyping in its early days and is still suffering from that. We've chosen the word telepresence, which is a term that was actually popularized by Marvin Minsky, primarily because we think that term offers a more accurate description of the medium that we're working in. We define telepresence as a medium through which a person can experience a sense of being present in another place or time than the one that their body currently inhabits. Now, most of you who've read books before have experienced empathy, which is a cousin of this effect, I guess, in the sense that we can experience other places or times through the imagination just by reading a book. And when you look at media like theatrical performance or video, you're then adding senses like the visual and the auditory. But the sense of embodied presence in another place or time is something that seems to be qualitatively different from the kind of imaginative empathy that's evoked by other media. So we're interested at Telepresence Research in investigating what kinds of technologies and experience designs can evoke this feeling, and obviously what it's good for. The telepresence effect that we're trying to achieve is this sense of presence. And we've learned that it is most likely to be achieved through a tight coupling of visual, auditory, and kinesthetic sensations. I guess maybe the best way to explain this is to talk a little bit about my first experiences in a telepresence environment. If you could show us our first slide. This was in the early days of the NASA VIEW laboratory, the Virtual Environment Workstation Laboratory, that was directed by Mr. Scott Fisher, who is the co-founder of Telepresence Research. This particular image is a wireframe model of the inside of the laboratory, and that little crab-like thing that you see on the screen is actually a reflection of the user's hand in the space. One thing that I've always found interesting is that VR people always seem to model their offices first. And I used to think this was really dumb. My office is boring enough. You reduce the polygon count, it's like excruciating. But it turns out that there's a really good reason for it. That is because if you've modeled a place that you're actually in, you can calibrate the system. Because when you reach out and touch something, you can actually get tactile feedback that the system is calibrated properly. When I first visited the NASA VIEW Lab in 1987 and had my first experience in telepresence, I visited a simulation of the space shuttle, which was a wireframe model of a similar quality to the office model that you just saw. And I put on the headgear and I put on the glove and I calibrated the system. And then I learned how to do what Myron Kruger calls finger flying. If you think about it, getting around in a virtual environment is fairly difficult because you can't see. There's something over your eyes, so you can't just walk off or you'll run into the wall. And oftentimes you're tethered by wires and cables. So you use gestures to move around, and this is finger flying. This means move me forward in the direction that I'm pointing. So I learned to do that, and I began to fly forward through this model of the shuttle towards the bulkhead. At about 4 to 8 frames a second, Scott says it was 8, I think it was closer to 4. So it's jumping along like this. It's very low resolution wireframe, and I'm headed for an empty trapezoid. And yet, when my body passed through it, every nerve ending went off. My brain was screaming, "You are about to encounter a solid object!" All kinds of red alerts were going off in my brain. The point of this tale is that at an extremely slow frame rate, in a very low resolution environment, this effect worked. So this is not about resolution, necessarily. This is about the coupling of two or more senses at once. And the essential senses seem to be the kinesthetic, that is, the sense of moving one's body around, and the visual. The goal of telepresence, we believe, is a kind of heightened experience that's achieved through sensory immersion. The sense of being inside another environment leads to some interesting effects. And it also has a rather long history as a technique that's been used by humans. Howard Rheingold, in his book Virtual Reality, suggests that maybe the first example of a virtual environment were the cave paintings in Lascaux. And it's interesting enough to take a moment to describe to you what his theory was about those paintings. As far as he could tell from reading anthropological literature, initiates to the tribe, male initiates to the tribe, were led through dark passageways by shamans or elders in the tribe to view these paintings, which encapsulated the wisdom of the tribe about hunting practices and also included some religious symbology. Now, imagine, if you will, being led through a dark, wet cave, a twisting way, your irises are hanging open, and suddenly a guy lights a torch, right? Bang! Huge, bright things happen in front of your retina. The torch is flickering. The animals seem to move. As the torch moves, these things animate even more, and the shamans begin to dump on you the big secrets of the tribe. Rheingold's thesis is that that's an experience you don't forget. And that the goal, then, of using telepresence or the virtual environment effect in this very early example was to enhance learning, to help imprint on people's minds a very important lesson. If we skip forward about 10,000 years from that period and talk about applications that we know today, such as scientific visualization, sensory immersion in three-dimensional data, and this is apocryphal, maybe, certainly anecdotal, but something that I believe to be true, giving a scientist the opportunity to be immersed in a three-dimensional data environment seems to improve that scientist's performance in noticing things, in visualizing things, because it evokes a kind of holistic involvement. In other words, the theory here is that the whole person, all of that person's senses working in concert, is more than the sum of its parts. And I think that we can find peripheral evidence in the world of perceptual psychology to suggest that when a person has a haptic relationship with an environment, one that involves kinesthetic behavior and tactile behavior, that their pattern-matching abilities are improved. We don't know how these connections work. We've barely begun to investigate them, but we have simply observed a certain improvement in performance in immersive environments. Certainly in entertainment-oriented applications, we've learned, and anybody who's been to Disneyland can attest to this, that sensory immersion tends to lead to increased emotional engagement, to increased empathy with the characters and environment, and to increased pleasure, if that sort of thing turns you on. We've called telepresence a medium previously, and I want to make sure that I make the point that we believe it to be a medium, not unlike television or film, in the sense that those things are media. Another reason for calling it a medium and not a technology is because, as we explore the domain, we discover that the telepresence effect can be achieved by many very diverse technologies. Some of them are entirely human, right? They don't involve computers at all. But in today's instantiations of telepresence, there seem to be some common technological components, and I wanted to review those with you now. The first is a three-dimensional head-coupled or surround display. I believe we have a slide of the head mounted display that was developed at NASA Ames Research. This woman is having a very good time. We're not sure what she was looking at, but I bet it wasn't the shuttle. This is a head mounted display. There's a tracking device on the eye, on the viewer, that's giving information to the computer about the location and orientation of her head. Okay, that information gets sent to the computer, and the computer uses that information to draw a slightly different picture whenever she turns her head. So she has the illusion of being surrounded by graphical imagery. That same tracker can also notice her translation through space, whether she's closer or farther away. Okay, so tracking the head and having a three-dimensional display that is usually achieved by giving a slightly different image to each eye seem to be essential components, at least with today's technology. However, in some experimental environments that we've seen and worked with in our shop, surround displays, especially if they're 3D, can achieve the same effect. The only limitation there is if you need to interact with or manipulate objects in the very near field, a surround display tends to break down as a delivery system. Certainly the early work in telepresence technology was not particularly aware of the importance of audio, and that was a fairly late development in the technology. We should move to the next slide, by the way, which gives you a different flavor of head-mounted display, although the same glove is being used. This is a system at Autodesk, which is for those of you who don't know, a software company that currently specializes in computer-assisted design programs. And this this technology is obviously natural for them. But you'll notice on this head-mounted display, as on others, there are earphones to deliver the three-dimensional audio. Let me describe to you first what that is. We are all familiar with stereo, right? You've got a speaker here, there's separation. But you don't have the sense that the drums are there and the guitar's back here, right? Things are emanating from the speakers. A binaural recording is one that allows us to localize sound in three space. Okay, so there, sound is at some distance in some location coming at you. But the way binaural recordings are produced means that they only work from one point of view because they're recorded from one point of view. So if I get up and walk around and turn my head, it doesn't work anymore. Three-dimensional audio allows a user to move through space and keep those sound sources where they are so that when I get closer, it gets louder. When it goes by me, maybe it Dopplers. And also to move the sound sources and have the acoustics work properly. Most of this work was done by Scott Foster, who is president of Crystal River Engineering, and also by Dr. Beth Wenzel at NASA. And today, the technology that Foster has developed is called the Convolvatron. And it's literally the only game in town in today's telepresence systems for delivering three-dimensional audio. The third seemingly necessary technology component in today's telepresence systems is some kind of hand and or body tracking. At the View lab, Scott Fisher's lab, Scott and his colleagues discovered that it really made a qualitative difference in the sense of presence to be able to get your hand in there. There's a real difference between being able to look around a space and being able to see your own body extended into it. And one of the things that we've noticed is the first time that people play around with telepresence, they get their hand in there and they're doing this. It's just like watching a newborn baby the first time they discover that their hand is there. Women in this room might remember that. It's also like watching people who are stoned, but that's another story. But it turns out that you can track things besides hands. If we could look at the next slide, Autodesk has created an interface that uses a bicycle. It's actually indirectly tracking what the body's doing by looking at how fast the wheels are turning and where the handlebars are going. The exercise bike telepresence system has become something of the holy grail of this business right now. Everybody's hoping that they can build one that's actually cheap enough to go in the Neiman Marcus catalog and will be more exciting than pedaling your exercise bike while you look at the television. Let's see the next slide from Autodesk, too. They even extended this idea of virtual sports at Autodesk to the idea of racket-based games. However, I must say that at the time this prototype was built, they were running at, I think, about 12 hertz, and it really does change your game after you've done an hour of racquetball at 12 frames a second. You will suffer badly on a real court for a while. Because your reflexes will be shot. What part of a body gets tracked and how it gets tracked is utterly application dependent. So that it may only be necessary to look at what a hand is doing, but it may be necessary to look at the whole body. For instance, if you're trying to play golf in a virtual world and you're only looking at hands, you're only getting a certain amount of information. You might also want to look at knees, at torque in the torso, and other things that help a computer understand what the swing this person just made is going to do to a virtual ball. So it's utterly application dependent. The other use of hand and arm tracking is in the case that you want to couple the human arm to a remote device that's actually performing work in the world, like a robot arm. And this kind of work was done at the NASA View Lab and is being pursued in many labs in Japan, the United States, and elsewhere for teleoperations. If we could look at the next slide, this is a sort of a new improved version of a glove, a sensor glove developed by Jim Cramer at Virtual Technologies. The nice thing about it is that it leaves your fingertips, one of the nice things about it is that it leaves your fingertips exposed for tactile feedback from maybe real objects in the environment. It's not putting stuff where you don't need stuff to be. It's very lightweight, it stretches, etc. Jim had another very cool idea, getting back to the floating crab in space problem with hands. He said, wow, I bet an arm and shoulder would help. And sure enough, it does. It helps a lot. My partner, Dr. Fisher, has a viewer at the office with one of those rubber pig noses on it. And that's to remind us all that we see our noses all the time. Now, look at your nose. It's there all the time. You just don't notice it. And we suspect that putting a nose in virtual environments might go even further in helping people to feel that they are embodied, that they have embodied presence. Of course, it would be big fun to put, you know, a different species kind of nose in there and see what that does to your self-concept. Telepresence enables people to have access to two different kinds of environments. One is commonly the one that we think of as virtual environments, environments that are generated by computers. But the other is real environments, either in real time, a remote environment that might be hazardous or too far away for you to get to, or displaced in time. With enough storage, we can store video information about a place and reconstruct it in a telepresence medium so that you can have the sense of moving around a place in a state that it was in the past. One of the reasons, again, why we think of telepresence as a whole medium is because it includes remote environments and because of our belief that eventually what will happen is that virtual environments and remote presence technology will converge, and then in most systems, for most applications, we'll be seeing what you might call hybrid imagery, imagery that combines real-world information or video-based camera-originated information with computer-generated information. If we could see the next slide. As long ago as the mid-60s, Ivan Sutherland, who developed, I believe, what was the first head-mounted display, made a see-through display. The display that he made allowed him to look out of the viewer. Do you have that next slide in there? There we go. You can see, this is not Ivan, I don't think. I think this is one of his graduate students. But you can see the little eyeballs there. This guy can see, but he's using half-silvered mirrors to reflect the imagery from those tubes onto the guy's eyes. The effect was to be able to hang a computer graphic in three space right in front of you and be able to walk around it and point at it and talk about it. Ivan Sutherland invented so many things, including computer graphics, that this one sort of got passed up, I think, for about 10 years. And as far as I know, the only guy who was seriously working on telepresence during that period was Dr. Tom Furness at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, who also made some very important inventions, especially in the area of optics. If we could see the next slide, I want to give you a couple of other examples of how hybrid imagery will pay off. This is a slide from a NASA project, and it gives an idea of the heads-up display of the future. You can see a flight path trajectory there. Other aircraft are being identified in the overlaid display. And displays like this already exist and are in use. The idea of making them stereo and of adding a three-dimensional audio environment to the cockpit is one that is very attractive right now to both military and commercial aviation. And finally, the third slide in this series demonstrates what I consider to be maybe the most lucrative application of hybrid imagery, which is to be able to populate your very own real space with virtual characters. I think there's some entertainment potential here in any case. You'll notice, by the way this works, and the reason Roger Rabbit did what Song of the South couldn't do, is that animators finally figured out that if you were going to integrate 2D characters into a 3D world, they had to have shadows and roundness and look kind of three-dimensional. So hybrid imagery is the wave of the future. I want to talk a little bit about applications and markets for telepresence before I show you a videotape. Our company is emphasizing entertainment, what I'd say at least to a 50% level, and there are a couple of reasons for that. One is that there seems to be some economic opportunities in that domain right now. Certainly there were more of those 3 or 4 months ago before the recession spread to Japan, but it does appear to be a fairly lucrative applications market, if not today, certainly within the next 2 to 3 years. Interestingly, one of the issues in using telepresence in public access environments right now is a hygienic one. People, especially in Japan, have expressed a lot of difficulty with the idea of putting on a head-mounted display. And I've seen enough of these things after they've been in public use to know that they get, like, way disgusting, very gooey. So in our videotape, you will see... It's true! You will see an alternative to a head-mounted display that lets people simply walk up to a device and look into it, much more like a telephone, less invasive and encrusting. And we think it's a very promising device for public access environments. It also takes less time to get in and out of. And if you're running an amusement park, throughput is a very important number because that determines how much money you're going to make. The other reason why our company is especially interested in entertainment, besides the fact that I'm a theater person and I've been in computer games for 15 years, is that we feel that if we can design the user interface for these systems so that it's effective for naive users in public access situations, we have solved probably have solved some important problems in ways that we can generalize to more specialized applications. Contrarywise, if we started by targeting rocket scientists or brain surgeons, we probably wouldn't have an interface necessarily that we could use in an arcade parlor. So this is really a strategy for solving interface problems, and it's a kind of a standard that we're holding ourselves up to as we think about the interface. Going back to my shuttle example, I can remember once I'd flown all the way through the shuttle and I got past it into the vast blackness of cyberspace, I couldn't figure out how to turn around. I couldn't figure out whether I should go like this or just turn around or, you know, go. I tried all of them and I got all wrapped up in the cables and fell over and they threw me out of the lab. But the point is, the point is that we don't know very much yet about what a natural interface is in situations like this. And working in a public access environment is a very, very good way to find that out. Learning is probably the original application for this technology, at least in America. Most of Telepresence's technological roots come from flight simulation training. Could I have the next slide, please? This is the only example of a military application I've seen that has a sense of humor. This is an attack cow force that was generated by Michael Zeile and his colleagues at the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California. It's a stereo virtual environment system that has ground-based cows, cows that fly in formation. This is a helicow. But you can actually fly around and shoot the cows, and if you hit one, it turns into a hamburger. Be that as it may, flight simulation training is being heavily invested in the telepresence area by the Defense Department. There's an operation called SimNet, for instance, which allows pilots to fly in a networked three-dimensional space, often mapping terrain captured by satellite imagery onto three-dimensional topographical models of areas where combat might occur, like, you know, the Middle East or something. In fact, they were flying around Kuwait a couple days before the invasion, from what I hear. Medicine is an obvious application that was pursued extensively at the NASA VIEW Lab in collaboration with Stanford University. They did a surgical simulator program that was used both for training and for pre-operation planning. We see great opportunities, certainly in the training area, in medical applications. At the University of North Carolina, there's a molecular modeling program that allows a scientist to scale himself down to the size of a molecule or smaller, and then through force feedback devices, actually find the docking sites and dock molecules and feel through force feedback what the bonding characteristics are. Their success is such that it suggests to us that there are applications certainly in the pharmaceutical business, for instance, for this technology. So that's another aspect of medicine that we see applications in. And finally, already in the medical domain, there was a lot of three-dimensional imagery. CAT scans are three-dimensional. And so the possibility exists for a physician to scale himself down and walk around inside of a patient's CAT scan. The scalability of the user is limited only by the resolution of the imagery. So it may actually be useful to go walking around and look at this guy's heart valve from this direction and see what's going on inside. Certainly wouldn't trust my doctor in there, but someday this may actually be a real application. And in design and engineering, we've seen a lot of really exciting work. Again, the University of North Carolina has done a great job in developing an architectural walkthrough system that would enable an architect to take a client through a building that's been designed, show the client the various parts of the building in different weather conditions at different times of day, and maybe the client would say, well, I want that window over there or make this door wider. And then since we have the data computationally, all we have to do is spit out another blueprint and we've revised the building together. Obviously, the same strategy could work for cooperative work when a three-dimensional kind of problem is involved. UNC certainly isn't the only outfit doing architectural walkthroughs. Sense8 Company, VPL, and many others have tried to enter this field, as well as the Human Interface Technology Laboratory at the University of Washington. There's another image, I think, in the slides, another design and engineering use. This was developed in Creon Levitt's laboratory at NASA. This is a virtual wind tunnel. The pink thing is a scale model of the space shuttle. And what this allows an engineer to do is to walk around that model and notice the aerodynamic, the airflow characteristics, and then to alter the model and see how those characteristics are changed. So that's another example of a design and engineering application. Even more applications, and I'll try to make this quick, scientific visualization is pretty much of a straight map from what we know of today as scientific visualization, but adding the third dimension in terms of the user's ability to move around inside of the data. And again, the scalability of the user is the very important one, because often in scientific visualization, what we're interested in is the relationships between patterns that occur at wildly different levels of resolution. Right, from the microscopic to the macroscopic. So with telepresence, the ability to zoom in and out of that is theoretically at least enhanced. And again, bringing to bear the haptic faculties of the person, we believe, improves performance in other ways that are not yet well understood. Applications with remote or hazardous environments were, I believe, first pursued at NASA, although that's probably not true. They were probably doing this long before that. The first things I heard of was work at NASA, again, with Scott Fisher's lab, to help astronauts do extravehicular activities remotely. In other words, put a robot out there instead of a human being. So you're not putting a person at risk, but letting a person operate a robot or machinery remotely through a telepresence interface so that he's still getting depth cues and all the other things that helps a person to perform a task. Obviously, this is a good technology for working in hazardous environments like nuclear power plants, underwater, and you'll see some examples of that in our videotape. And of course, it doesn't have to be a hazardous environment. It may just be a remote one that you can't afford to get to, like an Amazon rainforest, or one where the living presence of a human being would be too disturbing to the inhabitants, but one which you want to study. So there are peacetime applications of remote presence as well. And you'll see some that have to do with familiarizing yourself with other places in the movie in a minute. Finally, I want to talk just a second about telecommunications and what we call telecommunity, because this is an area that I'm extremely excited about. If we could see the next slide, please. This is a slide from a program called Habitat that was developed by Lucasfilm Games back in 1987. Randy Farmer and Chip Morningstar were the principal designers. This is a graphical interface to a computer network system, a phone network system, like CompuServe or the Source. But instead of seeing text on the screen, there are over 1,000 distinct physical venues rendered two-dimensionally. It's a very large universe. You go into the, when you log onto the system, you choose a body. You go to a head shop and buy a head. That went over real big in Japan when I described what that was. that's another story. And you can see your own image and the images of the other users, the ones that they've chosen for themselves, on the screen. The current version of Habitat has a limit of 6 people on the screen at the same time. And then you can type and say things to other users in real time. Some of the environments in Habitat are predisposed to certain kinds of activities. There are environments that just beg to make users go on treasure hunts. I mean, it's clear that that's what you ought to do there from the way the environment is designed. And what we've learned from watching people using the system is that they choose particular venues to meet. Little ad hoc communities of mutual interest will meet under the lamppost down at this end of the street. We've also seen, and Randy and Chip have documented, sort of amazing social and cultural activity that look very much like the kinds of things that happened on the great American frontier in the 18th and 19th centuries. For instance, in the early days of Habitat, there was a lot of difficulty with theft. People were stealing each other's heads. And this is a very sad situation. They were also stealing each other's possessions. So the residents of the Habitat got together and had a town meeting and decided that there ought to be some rules regarding this case. And then they talked to the sysops, and the sysops changed the world so that if you stole something inside city limits, you went back to your apartment and you had to stay there for 6 hours. Now, if you wanted to steal, you could go outside the city limits, and that was outlaw territory. My point here is that there's interesting social and cultural activity happening on nets that seems to be enhanced and accelerated through graphical interfaces. And I think that there are a couple of reasons for that. One very strong one is the ability to enhance one's self-representation. In our real lives and our everyday experiences, the tools that we have are fairly limited. We have gesture and mannerism and cosmetics and haircuts and fashion. Well, in a virtual environment, the palette is theoretically much, much larger. If we could look at the next slide, Barbara Mellon has given us an idea of what kinds of environments and bodies we might be able to create for ourselves at some time in the future in a virtual environment. So for me, that's a very interesting sort of cultural and social aspect of what this medium might enable us to do in a networked way. I think also that networked telepresence systems have the capability of revitalizing in us, in a particular way, a sense of place. In America in particular, the sense of place is not nearly as strong as it was 25 or 50 years ago. 5 miles from the center of any American city looks like 5 miles from the center of any other American city. I think I'm butchering that, but that's John Barlow's opinion of it all. The idea is that in a virtual environment system where we can actually collaboratively create spaces in which to carry on activities together, whether they be work activities, social activities, communication activities, that the relationship between place and human activity may be revitalized in some ways. And in fact, we've seen some evidence of that watching people use these systems now. And I think it's a very exciting aspect of the kinds of communities that we may form in the future. Communities that have more to do with mutual affinity and interest than they do with geography, nationality, or the other kinds of variables that currently are used to form communities in our society. At this point, I want to show you a videotape that Telepresence Research has produced. This is a concept tape, I guess you'd call it. We try to explain the concept of telepresence and to give you some footage of some actual systems working. There is a caveat. There's a section early in the tape where there's a model airplane flying around. And you'll see on the screen a notice that says 3D audio, wear stereo headphones. We're not broadcasting this program in stereo, so you're just going to have to trust us. But if you had earphones, you would be able to hear that plane moving around your head as it flies. So if you could, run the tape.
Marshall McLuhan observed that every medium is an extension of some human faculty. Watching a movie or reading a book can extend your attention to other dimensions. You forget about your body while your mind wanders off in some remote or imaginary place.
Consider a medium that enables you to take your body with you so that you could be physically immersed in a remote environment or experience an imaginary world from the inside. How would you get your body there? What would you want to do there? And how would you think about designing it?
The experience of being in an environment is often referred to as a sense of presence. The intensity of this experience seems to be created by several related factors. One is a sense of immersion in the environment, a feeling of being completely surrounded by it. Another is the ability to explore an environment, to move your viewpoint around the space, and to interact with things in it. And third, the experience of an environment is built up from information provided by all our senses at once. Sight, sound, touch, taste, and sometimes smell. Telepresence is a medium that enables a feeling of being present in another place or time. By matching human sensory capabilities as closely as possible, we can provide a sense of being physically present in a remote or synthesized environment. Currently, the most common form of telepresence involves three technologies in combination: very wide-angle stereoscopic displays, instrumented input devices that track gesture and viewpoint, and 3D auditory displays that allow localization of the sound in the virtual space.
Thank you. We're interested in 3D audio systems that work with headphone presentation. When you're using headphones, the idea is to present the appropriate signals that would be present in front of the ear canals of a listener located in a particular environment. One way to do this is called binaural sound. Binaural recordings are made by using a dummy head, or sometimes an actual human head with microphones in the ear canals, to capture the acoustic field in a particular place. When these recordings are played back over headphones, the listeners will typically report that the sound sources are outside their body and they feel as if they're actually in the space that was recorded. The problem with binaural recordings is as soon as the listener turns his head, the illusion is shattered. In a virtual audio display like this one, the idea is to calculate synthetic binaural signals that are then applied to the ears of the listener. By calculating these things in real time, under computer control, we can incorporate such things as head motion and user translation through the virtual environment. This turns out to be the key to an immersive and interactive virtual audio system. In this particular demonstration, there are four sound sources located within a room containing six reflecting surfaces, four walls, a ceiling, and a floor. Now, only the first reflections from each of these walls is calculated for each of the four sources. So it's a fairly thin model. But it's a truly dynamic one in that the sound sources can move in real time, the listener can look around and walk around in real time, and the reflection characteristics and positions of the walls can be adjusted at any time by the computer.
What does it mean to be at the ocean? It means being able to hear the surf and see the rocks. It means being able to turn your head and look at whatever you want.
Remote presence enables a person to experience and take action in a real place that may be physically distant, hazardous, or inaccessible. Places like a space station, a nuclear plant, a deep sea canyon, or even inside a human heart.
We're making progress building devices that make remote presence possible. The key is to get our brains to accept sensory input from these devices. One trick is to make the interface with the device as fluid as possible. Another key is to approximate human perceptual capabilities by using appropriate technologies such as high-resolution displays and fast head trackers. Much of what we do is specified in the domain of perceptual psychology. But what we are finding out is that by spending many hours experiencing remote environments through these devices, we can jump ahead of science and discover effects that have yet to be quantified. Indeed, we can experience worlds that have yet to be perceived.
How do we avoid getting lost in a virtual environment? The trick is to give people a sense of unified space and to adapt navigation cues that we use in everyday life. Surrogate travel is a cinematic record of a place that provides multiple possibilities for getting from here to there. The images are more realistic than computer-generated material, but less interactive since, for the time being, one can only travel where the camera recorded. The Aspen movie map was the first attempt to simulate navigation through an actual place with interactive video discs. In Paris, a mime pointing directions exploits people's familiarity with cinematic editing conventions. The Golden Gate video disc provides an abstract, hyper-real experience by allowing people to overlook the Bay Area at speeds much faster than normal. The Karlsruhe project explores the 100 kilometers of tramway track as a geographic and historical basis for getting to know this German town. Visual immersion can be achieved in many ways. You don't have to wear it on your head. The panoramas and cycloramas of the 19th century were giant wraparound screens. Stereoscopic movies of the 1950s added the dimension of depth. Projection environments can induce the sense of immersion. A space can be revealed by partial views, like a flashlight probing the dark. Projection screens can be three-dimensional surfaces. Physical objects and even live performers can be integrated with media to create complex environments. Many new and hybrid genres of telepresence remain to be discovered. They will require careful research. They will also require the sort of unabashedly free expression and exploration we associate with art.
A lot of technology has been concerned with extending human senses into places that are otherwise inaccessible to our species. Sometimes the motive is survival, more often it's curiosity. The Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute, MBARI, was founded in 1987 to explore the physics, chemistry, and biology of this complex marine ecosystem. With a remotely operated submarine, MBARI scientists have often observed life forms that were previously unknown to humans. At 1,000 meters below sea level, where there are no luminosity or terrain cues, it's difficult to judge sizes and distances. Telepresence can afford a three-dimensional view and the ability to look around by turning one's head. Control of remote sensors can be coupled to the scientist's body as if he were there. Rather than operating the manipulator arm with knobs and dials, you can maneuver it with your own reach and grasp. Research challenges in remote presence include peripheral device engineering, human interface design, and data transmission. MBARI has collected gigabytes of sensor data and hundreds of hours of videotape in this deep sea canyon. In order to process all this information, scientists must examine it in diverse forms, in various places, and at different times. With the telepresence medium, these data sources can be integrated into a single experience base.
Visitors to the Monterey Bay Aquarium may watch live video transmission from the MBARI submarine. Telepresence can help us explore and learn in ways that seem natural to us, through experiences that involve us physically and emotionally, as well as intellectually. Computer-based characters can guide people through virtual environments, finding and retrieving information that's stored there, acting as playmates, teachers, or navigators. Entertainment in telepresence means enabling people to experience environments that speak directly to the imagination. Someday, soon, telepresence technology is going to be able to give people a sense of being in extraordinarily rich environments, with seemingly unlimited degrees of freedom. And the question becomes, what are you going to do when you get there? Clearly, pre-planned alternatives and simple branching choices are not going to be enough. The art of experience design means building the potential for interesting things to happen into the environment, the objects, characters, the qualities of the world itself. On a migratory trail 1,000 years ago, Native Americans carved pictures here in these rocks. Carvings like these were not found near places where people lived.
They were found within monumental landscapes. At the heart of every medium is the desire to elicit deep participation with an environment. Our senses are what make the connection. Telepresence may be many things. It may become a tool, a game machine, or maybe just a mutant form of TV. But for telepresence to achieve its potential, we must reinvent the kind of spaces where we collaborate with an environment in order to transform ourselves. Hi there, welcome back. I wanted to cover briefly as a conclusion some of the most important research issues that I personally foresee in this domain. And I may be biased because of my background and interests. In most of the areas of enabling technology, which you'll find notes about in your book, we can see far enough ahead to know where incremental progress can be made. And there are only a few areas like tactile feedback where we don't have something that looks like a pretty good candidate for a silver bullet. The problems that we're facing now, in my mind, are more formal, conceptual, and artistic than they are technological. In particular, let me mention four of them to you. The first, I think, is understanding how the forms that this medium might support are evolving. In traditional linear media like film, theater, or written literature, the form of a piece of work is dictated by the artist. It's really a kind of a top-down process. The artist has more or less total control over the shape of the whole. But in an interactive medium, that picture changes completely. Now the shape of the whole lives somewhere out here between me, the originating artist, who is not here with you in real time, and you as you participate with it. Something entirely different is going on, and it requires an entirely different approach to the task of authoring. Instead of directly controlling the texture and shape of a plot, we now have to think about indirectly controlling it by presenting possibilities and suggestions to people as they move through a world. And we have to also agree, I think, that explicitly constraining the user by means of error messages or menus, et cetera, is probably not going to be very effective in a telepresence environment. Instead, you may need to drop a safe on his head. But you certainly don't want to have the voice of God coming in and interrupting what's going on. And that leads me to the second point, which is that we need to investigate alternatives to linearity in the way that we think about plot. Certainly a great deal of progress has been made here in the world of computer games, and I recommend to you the work of Ron Martinez and his crew at Transfiction Systems in the game, for instance, Hidden Agenda. By the way, Ron has renamed his company Post-Linear Media, which is a great new buzzword I hope we all adopt. I just wanted to give credit to Ron for inventing it. We look to theatrical improvisations for inspiration, and this is an area in which I'm extremely active these days. And especially also looking to non-Western cultural and literary traditions. I've convinced myself at least that, in particular, Native American lore and mythology and the lore and mythology of Aboriginal Australian people are very fertile sources of new structural and formal paradigms and indeed new concepts altogether of what experience design might consist of. And finally, my advice to people who are trying to work in this medium now is to remember that when you're developing tools, you should be working very closely with the person who's going to use them.
And the first generation tools have to be optimized for skills transfer from the domains where those people worked before. And we've found that the very best strategy is to strap an artist to an engineer. But in the future, the second generation of tools will look completely different, because you'll be dealing with a generation of folks who got thrown in the pool when they were 6 months old and know how to swim in this medium. And finally, our attitude towards what it means to invent a medium, I think, needs to change at this juncture in the life of telepresence, at least. The inventing that's been done on the technology side has now reached critical mass, where we can see that we have a medium, we have the capability to deliver a certain kind of experience. And we've also gone through a process that seems to be true of every medium as it evolves, namely the process of recapitulating media that went before. Television imitated radio, right, and vaudeville, and film to a certain extent. And it had to do those things in a certain way before it became itself, for better or for worse. In telepresence, as well as in computer games, which I think is a related field, we've done the same thing. We've recapitulated a narrative model to a certain extent, and we've recapitulated a dramatic one. And now, in a sense, it's time to give up control and stand back and look for emergence. So my advice to people who are working in this field is to build lots of examples, play around with them with lots of artists and lots of users, and see what happens. Thanks.